So I want to thank Julie, who moderated the previous panel, and I did the first one, but now we actually have like a professional moderator. So it's my great honor to introduce Alice Park, who works for Time. And she's, many people have lamented the loss of journalism. She's a health journalist who's really good, who is doing the right thing, and we need more people like her. And we're very honored to have her to moderate this last panel. So Alice, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you very much, Gary, for the kind introduction. So I know that we are what's standing between you and the beginning of a long weekend, but I promise this will be worth your while and very productive. So I know throughout the day we've been addressing big themes, challenges facing data science and public health. And in this session, we're going to tackle what I think is a conundrum, really, in data science, which is that data can theoretically or should be objective, but data science isn't always. And that's because of the way we collect the data, the way we interpret it, and the way we apply it. So we're going to address and tackle all of those issues with this very qualified panel we have here today, and which I'd like to introduce right now. To my immediate left is Dr. Francesca Dominici, who is the Clarence James Gamble Professor of Biostatistics, Population and Data Science, and co-director of the Data Science Initiative at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. To her left is Jeff Goldsmith, Dr. Jeff Goldsmith, Associate Professor of Biostatistics here at Columbia Mailman School of Public Health. And finally is Dr. Lance Waller, Professor of Biostatistics and Bioinformatics at the Rollins School of Public Health at Emory University. So I think we're going to start with having a very brief presentations to kick off our discussion, and we'll start with Francesca.
Thank you. See if I can get my slide. I was asked to push the green.
She's pushing the green button, I promise.
Thank you. Thank you for being
vouching, absolutely.
Thank you for being ethical. So I wanted to, when we talk about data ethics, it's always easy to talk in a general sense and doing things in the good way. So what I thought to do in my very limited amount of time is actually to talk about what are the concrete ethical challenges that a data scientist like myself face when I'm trying to do data science in a highly contentious political climate. So I'm really, with the best of my intention, try to do the right things, try to take all the right principle, but the climate is really against what I'm trying to do. And also, I wanted to give a viewpoint of how some of the really important data science principles that often are called ethical data science, like reproducibility or assessing causality, can be twisted for the wrong reason. So I'm pushing the red button. Okay. So this is the political climate. There is nothing that it's there that you don't know in terms of the current, the current administration and the current EPA being pretty reluctant and has been a direct attack to science in terms of implementing environmental regulation, in terms of evidence of climate change and all of that. So my work, and I'll tell you in the few minutes I have, has been really to be at the front line on trying to take and harness all of the possible available data, link them, and through my many colleagues and many new data science development, to provide evidence-based results to the EPA to ask whether or not to reduce the level of pollution in the air, but also what are the climate change risks that are associated with health. So now when you publish a top journal in the New England Journal of Medicine or in JAMA, this is a letter and a picture of me. So first of all, let me say one thing that I'm really upset about. This is a horrible picture of me. Let's make that clear. But on top of that, so this is, it was published in junkscience.com and said, no air pollution not associated with hospitalization of elderly, more junk from Francesca Dominici and the Harvard Air Scare Mafia. You will get no veritas from the air quality work of the Harvard's Francesca Dominici. Mm-hmm. So this is from the junkscience.com. You can Google and have fun. Steve Malloy is the senior advisor to environmental issues in the Trump administration, a graduate of the Biostatistics Department of Bloomberg School of Public Health, from which I was a faculty member for 12 years. He didn't graduate when I was there. Just want to make it clear. And, you know, and I'm not the only one. This is all me and my colleagues doing this. This one was sent to all of the editor-in-chief of New England Journal of Medicine, JAMA, British Medical Journal, to the president of Harvard, to the provost of Harvard, and I was accused of misconduct. So that's just the starting line of, yes, we try to do good, but what really does it mean to be good and to do good? This is not working. Should I go somewhere? Okay, so I hope it's not gonna take so long every time. So what, you know, going back to the contextualization of the question that we try to answer is a highly contentious in terms of that is try to ask to provide evidence as whether or not the National Ambient Air Quality Standard for fine particulate matter are safe to human health. And the reason why this is so contentious is that if this is by law, by the Clean Air Act, if myself and many of my colleagues, data scientists, provide robust evidence, they're saying that the current level of air pollution are harmful to human health, the National Ambient Air Quality Standard need to be lowered, and that means billions of dollars for the oil and automobile industry. Yeah, I think Charles. I'm getting, thank you. And so going back to data science, this is not working either. Jeff, just get up.
She's pushing every
time. Okay. So the most important, one thing that's not mentioned that is really important, both for ethical issues, but for advancement of data science, is the building of research data platform. Because when we're thinking about elevating science, and especially in highly contentious environment, getting the best possible data and linking in the best possible way is indeed important. Although I don't think that we are training or investing enough resources on developing a research data platform. So what we have been doing is taking all of the possible data, and I'm sorry, now it's going too fast, but this is my quote, and my sense is this is a quote from Marilyn Monroe, where she said, given a girl the right shoes, and she can conquer the world. I think I'm twisting her quote by saying, given the girl the right data, and she can conquer the world. And so I think the important access to data and the linkage of data is indeed the critical to advance highly political questions. So these are the data where it's all publicly available data. The claims data from Medicare and Medicaid claims are not free, but they are publicly available. And then I'll tell you that it's really important, because it's important that we use government data to advance issues that are indeed of a cost to the government. So anyway, the work I've done has had a lot of coverage and a lot of impact, but the problem is that as a result of impact, the ethical issues arise. So there are two important ethical issues that I wanted to talk about, and I think two important data science principles that we predicate, that we teach, but they have been twisted so that it's favoring the current political climate. One issues pushing. Okay. One issue is the transparency rule. And so this is important that you think about how data science, the twisting of data science. So we all know and we all predicate based on the fact that reproducibility of science and replicability of science is extremely important. I'm having a trouble with this. So let me restart, because I've been very, very, very distracted by this issue. So So when we talk about data science, so there are two principles that we predicate and we think that is really important. And I wanted to show you, in the context of environmental health and climate change, they're being twisted in the wrong way. So one is the issue of reproducibility, replicability, and access to data. And we all know that open source code and data are indeed important to be made accessible to replicate analysis. This issue, unfortunately, this principle has been twisted where now, under the current administration, and we can talk more about that in the discussion, have been used against to what type of science that can inform regulatory policy. So basically, there is a new rule under discussion that said that unless the epidemiological study or every study that use health data are not made publicly available, so means that health data has to be made available to the public, that study cannot inform regulatory standard. And that is a clear attack to all of the evidence has been produced about that has been produced up to now to provide evidence of harmful effect of air pollution. So that's one principle where reproducibility is good, but limit a study or scientific consensus to inform policy unless the data are publicly available has been twisted in the wrong way. Next, please. The second one is causality, all right? So we now teach about causality. We have been, there is an enormous statistical literature on the importance of estimating causality in the analysis of observational data. This is another issue where it's ethical, it's good, it's one of the criticisms of the machine learning approaches because machine learning cannot assess causality. But here is a case where it's been twisted in the wrong way. So the new chair of the Clean Air Act Advisory Board, and there's been now a new requirement where said, unless a study can show causality from the analysis of observational data, that study cannot be used to inform policy. And you know, we all know that absolute proof of causality in analysis of observational data is impossible. So in my little time, and I'm sorry to be a little bit scattered, I wanted to conclude with a few thoughts. So first of all, I've been reading and study a book. It's called Why Trust Science by an historian. Her name is Naomi Raskas. So she's a professor of history. And I've been thinking a lot about how data science can really help in advancing science and how we in our community can do that. So she's bringing, and I want to quote her because these are really her ideas from her book. I think the important thing to always to keep in mind is that how you build consensus, how you think about rigor in the method, how you establish evidence, what type of values you have, and that you're doing things with humility. And then I wanted to conclude with just some advice. I do think that even though being on the front line on important issues in data science, where there are ethical issues and there are political issues, I do believe and think passionately that working on important problems is absolutely necessary and is really an opportunity for our data scientists, also because the most innovative methodological contribution in data science comes from working on real problems where you are under scrutiny. Always aim high, because I think that now with the data science expertise, we have the opportunity and the talent to change things, like change national ambient air quality standards, and so definitely we can. We are at a time where it's very easy to compromise integrity and rigor, both because of financial reason and because I personally don't like to have my photos, going around and say I'm part of the Harvard Mafia. But, especially also bad photo of me. But I think that it's important that we resist at all costs to not fall in the trap of integrity. And I just want to conclude with one statement. I think it's really important that you empower your mentee to do things that they really want to do to change the world, but at the same time to be very aware of what are the traps, and sometimes the good principle in data science can also be twisted in the wrong way. So thank you, and apologize for Thank you, Francesca.
All right,
Jeff, we're going to give it a try.
Good luck.
Can you confirm he's pushing the button?
It works. I want to start out by saying that some of Francesca's key messages that she closed on are things that she's been saying for years. When I was a student at Hopkins and she was a faculty member at Hopkins, and I won't say how long that has been for both of our sakes, but at that time, she said many of the same things, that it's important for people who are in public health, who are in biostatistics, to be working on important problems and to expect there to be pushback and to be able to stand up for that, to do the data analysis that you're going to do in a way that you feel confident in your convictions. So that's not just like a recent thing for an ethics panel. That's what she's been saying for years. I am going to take a different approach. I'm not going to talk about a project that I've worked on, and I'm not even really going to talk about a project that has anything to do with health. What I am going to talk about something that is something that I think will be familiar to people, and if it's not, I'll give sort of a brief history, but I think it clarifies some of the ethical challenges that come up in data science. So there's a few years ago, there was an introduction in Google Translate. They launched AI. For a long time, Google Translate had been built around the idea that if you know every word in two languages and you can map the grammar from one to the other in a very systematic way, then that's the way that you ought to go about doing translation. And sometime around 2015 or 2016, they said, no, what we're going to do instead is use AI to do all of that translation automatically. If we have enough text in this language and the matching translation in this language, then we can just train something that will do that translation for us. And so it's not going to be the sort of symbolic approach where we really have to map every single idea from one language to another. We're just going to let computers solve this problem for us. And this really was, especially initially, hailed as a great disruption and a real way forward. A lot of the initial reaction was that not just were the translations good, they were substantially better. You know, that the symbolic AI, the process that had been used previously, to get the same kind of advances would have taken years and years and years and years of work, and the AI was able to do that sort of overnight. And so the kind of articles that came out, like the Great AI Awakening, I think this one was in the New York Times, was very complimentary of the effort, sort of suggested that AI was not just going to change Google Translate, but was really going to change an awful lot of things. I guess this was in like 2015 and 2016, back in the good old days when everybody thought that tech was on our sides and everybody was going to be like really happy with everything that was going on. And I don't know that that's as true now, but it certainly was true then. And what happened though was that it turned out that many of these translations, when you really dug into what was going on, that Google Translate was reproducing the biases in the text that had been used to train that algorithm in the first place. And this isn't surprising, I would imagine, to many people in the room, and you may be familiar with this story, but even artificial intelligence can acquire biases against race and gender. This is a headline in another a publication. Google Translate's gender bias pairs he with hardworking and she with lazy, among other examples. Some enterprising folks on Twitter put together, a post. He is a soldier, she's a teacher, he is a doctor, she is a nurse, right? Like the kinds of things that you look at and like I'm looking out here and everyone's like, ah. And I would say that if that's the reaction that everybody has, and I think it's pretty clear that this was unethical in at least some way. And it's actually sort of interesting, the way they found this out was taking sentences in English, translating it to Turkish, which has gender-neutral pronouns, and translating it back to English. And so they would sort of see what happens if you go from a language with no gender encoded and you translate it to English. And this is sort of what happened. So how did this happen? The text here is really small enough you might not be able to see it. I'd say how this happened is sort of in two directions. There's like the practical perspective or the technical perspective is that the data that was being fed into the AI algorithm was inherently biased. It was sort of drawn from how people speak, not thinking about what the gender biases might be. And it just sort of picked up on what was naturally baked in to the way that people express themselves. And then the other thing that happened was sort of AI, right? And I put AI in quotes here. We had a nice introduction to AI earlier on, sort of what happens when you start doing these deep networks. I actually sort of like this YouTube video for explaining how AI works, and this is a still taken from this YouTube video where there's this sort of, robot with a network coming out of its brain, and the person who has trained that robot's hand, I don't know, you put stuff in and stuff comes out, and it seems like it's doing okay, and in a lot of ways it feels like that's what AI is doing, and I think that in some ways is like how this happens. When you train an algorithm in a way that seems to give good answers, but you don't necessarily think too deeply about, you don't really understand, you can end up reproducing biases in ways that you wouldn't want to. But then there's also sort of a step culturally, how did this happen? Google had one motto and then another one. Their first motto was don't be evil, and they updated that to do the right thing. But either way, I would say there is a culture in at Google, in data science, in companies in general. Google is a company, and Google is going to do the things that Google needs to do to sell more advertisements. And that's maybe a very cynical way of thinking about what Google does, but I think that perspective, understanding what Google's motivations are they responsible for chasing down biases that exist in their translate algorithms? Is that something that is inherently meaningful to their culture? I think that's something that we need to think about. And then there's sort of the follow-up question, sort of a broader question, not just at Google, but is data science, are data themselves sort of inherently ethical or unethical, or is it just sort of what happens with those data or what data scientists do that can be evaluated in this way? So I don't think of myself necessarily as somebody who is an expert in ethics. And so what I did was like went and said, what do philosophers think about this? Philosophers being people who at least might spend a lot of time thinking about what right and wrong actually is. And so I found a paper, What is Data Ethics in Philosophical Transactions? This was one of several papers that I found. I went down sort of a wormhole of whether or not Amazon undermines free will, and that's not exactly relevant. It does, I've been convinced. In the name of pulling up a quote, I'll read this. Navigating between the Scylla of social rejection and the Charybdis of legal prohibition in order to reach solutions that maximize the ethical value of data science to benefit our societies, all of us, and our environments is the demanding task of data ethics. And the two things that I took away from that were that public health and statistics really does not put enough Greek mythology in our publications. And the other, after I read this a few times, what they're sort of saying here is if your algorithm is so inherently unethical that people revolt, then that's clearly bad. And if the sort of legal reaction is to prohibit any development in data science or artificial intelligence, well, that's probably also bad too. And what you really have to do is navigate between these two things. And they laid out three areas of ethics as they relate to data science that I thought were really useful. So there's the ethics of data collection. What does it mean to collect the data? Who needs to consent to have their data collected? And what control does a person have over that? Would they object to that data being shared, and in what context? The second one, I thought that first one seemed fairly natural in the context of public health. The second one was the ethics of algorithms, which I had to think a little bit about. It had not occurred to me to question, is Lasso an ethical algorithm? Is it more or less ethical than artificial intelligence? It is absolutely ethical, that's fine. But the way of asking that question, or a way of asking that question, is how frequently does an algorithm have unintended negative consequences? How frequently, if you just start using AI for everything, how often is that going to end up in a bad outcome that you didn't expect and you didn't try to head off in the first place? And that is at least some way of thinking about what it means for an algorithm itself to be ethical. And I think that's useful. I think there's nothing, I don't know, I think logistic regression can have negative unintended consequences. And we can talk about some examples where that's the case. But AI might be more problematic. It might be more challenging as a tool to ensure that it's used ethically. And then there's the ethics of practice. What are sort of the inherent values that are shared by the data science community? And that's something that we have touched on a little bit, and I don't have enough time to go into a lot right now, but I think hopefully it comes up in the discussion as we go on. But if you sort of think about each of these ethics, those would come together to ensure that data science is doing something that is right in the end, that is ethical overall. And I think that's a useful roadmap for thinking about ethics in data science. And I also think that public health has a head start on a lot of these. We think an awful lot about where our data come from and who they represent and whether or not people have consented to have information in this way. And we think an awful lot about what are the practices and the values that we want to instill in our community. And so I think we're in a good position. I'm not going to say that like we're the computer scientists are not also thinking ethically, but I think public health is in a really good position to be thinking about this. And I think it's an area where we ought to be at the forefront. And so I'll sort of end by saying that Google did work to sort of fix this disruption in a way that was algorithmic. And so there was some work that came out of Stanford. Word embeddings quantify 100 years of gender and ethnic stereotypes. And so they designed an AI update, a way of sort of identifying what those biases were and removing them algorithmically. And so you end up with translations where if something goes from Turkish, where it is gender neutral and is translated into English, now sort of both are being provided. So you get he is a doctor or she is a doctor, depending on what sort of gender you're looking for. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and end.
Thank you, Jeff. A lot to chew on there that we'll come back to. Lance.
Great. A couple of things. Not too long ago, there was a study going on where there was you would post your picture. There's the Google thing that'll line you up with famous pieces of art, or not so famous pieces of art if you don't look like Michelangelo's David or something. There's another one that would put your face and it would say what words are most associated with features on your face. And this was it was kind of a study of the bias, but there was a lot of negative feedback. So right before they pulled it down, I had read an article about it. I thought, well, I'll try it. So I put my official picture from work, and I, you know, clenched my teeth and pressed the button, and the word that came up was co-pilot. And I'm still pondering what this means. I have been known to tell people my favorite job would be the really helpful second in command. I didn't really want all the responsibility, but I liked, you know, being in charge of something. So that's one. I totally agree we don't have enough Greek mythology or mythology in general in our discussions. I've been leading data science planning in the Health Sciences Center at Emory for the last year and a half, and I start every one of our meetings with this meeting's mythology. So Scylla and Charybdis, of course, came up because everybody wants something, and you got to get through the middle. I also chose some more modern ones like the Kobayashi Maru, which is, so they're like the three Star Trek fans out here with me recognize that's the computer simulation at Starfleet Academy for captains, and there's no way to win. It's an unwinnable situation. However, Captain James T. Kirk realized the way to win it is to get out of the box, reprogram the simulation so there's a way to win. So you can call that cheating, or you can call it as that's winning the game. And then the Mirror of Erised from Harry Potter, everyone sees what they want to see. So when you're first starting the planning, everyone's really happy. They're all going to get what they want. They think it's going to be free. And then you start saying, we're going to do this, and it's going to cost you, and someone has to get paid to do it. They're less optimistic. Finally, my son's a classics, got a degree in classics. He's doing digital humanities now. And so I asked him for a Latin pronunciation. So the Statistical Society of London was founded in 1834. It became the Royal Statistical Society. Their logo now is still a sheaf of wheat. And that might make sense for the Rothamsted experiment station and so on. But the original one had a ribbon around it with a Latin motto that said, Alias Exterendum, which translates to, let the others thresh it out. And so at the time, it was a highly contentious political environment in London, and they said, as statisticians, our job is to do the calculations correct, and you figure out what it means, which falls a little short, and I think no one would be satisfied with that in this room. And I think I'm really pleased for the organization of the summit today, and the conversations we've had so far have all led to a lot of things we do. Now I'm going to begin. This is now the modal slide of my career. It just surpassed my Monty Python animation of Jon Snow, not the Game of Thrones one, but the cholera one, looking at the map and his eyes getting bigger, which took a long time, and it's hard for me not to put it in a slide. But this is I whimsically called this the whirling vortex of data analysis when I thought I could still be cool, and you know, that's over. When I moved to Atlanta 21 years ago, I went down to the EPA Region 4 office in downtown Atlanta, and John Richardson was a toxicologist. I work in geographic information systems. We were talking about spatial analysis. He said, it's just like this, and he grabbed a scrap of paper, and since it's an ethics, I can't say it was the back of an envelope, but I really wish it was. It'd be such a better story. And he drew this picture. He said, it starts in the top left. There's a question you want to answer. Now, we've heard this today, throughout today. There's a question you want to answer. Now, before you do anything, now a lot of us skip this step, but before you do anything, think about what data would you need to really answer that question. And it may be a big question. It may be, does exposure to hazardous waste in water in a hazardous waste site near a water source, does that cause an increase in risk of childhood leukemia or something like that? That's a big question you're unlikely to completely answer, but that's your motivating question. So what date? I need to know where the kids lived. I need to know how much water they drink. How much water is their house on private water, public? There's a whole lot of things I would like to know. And then I make some compromises moving to the right, the data I can get. I might be able to get school enrollment data. I might get it at an aggregate level. We've talked about aggregation and individual before. So there's the data I can get, and there's the tools I have to work on that data. And then I move up, and those are the questions I can answer with the data I have available and the tools I have available. And I think Rob talked about this question, and that the answer may be that you can't answer that, or I tend to prefer taking these steps. I have made some compromises along the way, and the question I answered isn't exactly the question I was motivated with, and the big arrow connecting that and making this a loop is how close is it? And then I've gone around once, now what other data would I need to get a better answer? Can I get that data? Maybe it was more work, and that's why I didn't get it the first time. So maybe I get some of it, or I get a little bit of it, and maybe that helps, and then I go around again. Or there's a new method, and that might let me answer questions in a different way. So the combination of data, questions, and methods, these things interact, and I would argue that they're dynamic. They go around and around. So when I present this to undergraduates, recruiting them to graduate studies in biostatistics or another quantitative health field, one question I got was, well, how do you know when you're done? And it floored me, and I thought, well, I've never finished anything. So no, it's not really whether you got to the answer, because this is really the scientific process if we stretched it out linearly and we stopped. But really, our investigations keep going. It's not whether we answered the question completely. It's just, do I know more about it now than I did before? Now, you could be mistaken, and so sometimes you need to find the mistake. But so, you know, we want there to be progress along the way. So this whirling vortex and talking about the tools you use. The other slide I have for the recruitment is a picture of a screw, and it says problem. And then the other one, the next slide has a hammer and a screwdriver and a wrench, and it says tools. And I said, every one of those can solve that problem. I mean, you can drive a screw with a wrench. I would not recommend it. But we do that with data sometimes. We'll force it through some way when there's actually a more elegant tool. And there's one smart aleck in the back of the room who goes, that was a Phillips head screw, and that's a flathead screwdriver, every single time.
You haven't fixed your slide?
No, I'm not fixing my slide. I like calling that person out. Mm. It engages them. I call it mentoring. One of the things I think Emory is going to incorporate in its data center is it also has, or data science center, it also has a large center of ethics. And so we have a really nice collection of ethicists and philosophers to work on these issues. Now, those of you who have done human subjects certification, you're familiar with the list I have here. These are a list of Western ethical moral principles that you may recognize from doing your, so non-malfeasance, do no harm. Okay, that's good. We want to do that. Beneficence, which I have a hard time pronouncing, free and informed choices, justice. At first, this bothered me a little bit. Treat equals equally, treat unequals unequally. And it bothered me until I was getting in the TSA line, and I thought, yeah, okay, I get this now. I was okay with it. And then after I got through and got to my gate, I felt bad about it. But at the time, I was like, yeah, this totally makes sense. Utility is maximizing benefit over harm for all people. Fidelity is keeping your promises and agreements. Honesty is do not lie, defraud, or mislead. And privacy is respecting personal privacy. This is from a really nice paper a year ago in May in the American Statistician by three statisticians who teach at Southern Methodist University. And it was like using cross-cultural concepts in teaching ethics and statistics. So most of us who have training grants have a responsible conduct of research. And we run through this, and then our students go through this. So we're familiar with the Belmont Report, the Nuremberg Trials, all of that. Well, the argument they had there was they have a lot of students coming from non-Western cultures as well, and what moral principles are they exposed to? And so I'm not claiming to be an expert on this, but what they did by talking to their students and faculty members was also make a list of Confucian moral principles and philosophies that have been around for a long time. So benevolence, connectedness and altruism to all people. Righteousness, making correct decisions, choosing correct decisions over material gain. Ritual propriety, treating all life with honor. Wisdom, the importance of learning, high value on the importance of learning. Trustworthiness is acting with loyalty. And filial piety, respecting ancestors and tradition. And you know, I thought when I got the two lists, oh, this is great, I'll just draw a line from this one to this one. It's much more complicated than that. It looks a lot like the deep learning diagram. And so the mental picture I have now is if you had a rectangle that described all of moral principles, each of these concepts is a shape that fits over part of it. And every culture will try to build, as human beings that like to live in society, we want to have rules on how we interact with each other. So we want to cover these things. And if there's gaps, we come up with a principle that didn't quite make it. So what you'll with the limited list. So these two lists cover a lot of the space, but they're not identical versions of each other. And so sometimes this can be a challenge in teaching ethical concepts because you're making assumptions that you all have the same background. So ethics draw from moral principles. Moral principles tend to try to come from underlying sense of right and wrong that we hope is universal, and a lot of it is, but once we parcel it into pieces and start naming it, then they don't line up quite so much. And I think this is important for not only training students who aren't familiar with the Western list in canon, but also treating the Western-based students on what the weights and so on. So, Brahmer, there's more weights here, so we'll set up some prior distributions and we'll be all fine. So those two, I'd encourage you to read this paper. I think it's a really excellent. It doesn't cover everything, and the one citation to it to date is a article about teaching and setting up statistical curriculum in an Islamic environment, and it was pointing out they needed to develop a similar list and so on. So I think these are really helpful. The American Statistical Society has a webpage of ethical practice for guidelines for ethical statistical practice. It took 50 years to get approved. Not because statisticians aren't unethical, but statisticians were concerned that they were so objective that there was no need to claim to need to be ethical. So those were approved, and this was several years ago. They've been revised a couple of times since, and it is worth reading them. They will be similar to the Western principles you saw there, and your respect to your collaborators, and respect to the data, and respect to science, and so on. During the earlier promotion discussion, which is also an ethical issue, I was going to stand up and say, oh, someone should write a paper about this. And then I went, oh, wait, I did. An American Statistician, also in 2018, there's a paper that we put together as part of a panel discussion on valuing contributions in data science and tenure and promotion in biostatistics and statistics departments, because that's the world I live in. But I think the ideas are general. Some of the mentoring up, junior faculty working in this area, if they're only talking about it at the voting meeting, that's pretty late in the game. But some things you can do are your chair needs to be on board with this. Chair can recommend areas of outlets for your scientific productivity. And we've talked a little bit about the peer-reviewed data curated resources, so they're citable. They get a DOI. Some of your data descriptions that usually get buried in the supplemental information, those can be standalone DOI papers as well. That kind of turns things back into publications, which maybe isn't totally fair, but maybe expedient. Another thing you can do is point out to your chair who's doing really cool work in this area, especially if they're senior somewhere else, and have them come give a seminar to your department so that the senior faculty who will be voting on you see them come in and go, oh, that's kind of cool work. You're doing stuff like that. There are little things, but it's education both up and down the system, because the responsibility is not necessarily the tenure system's biased against you. It's that the people who are voting aren't familiar with this, so you can't really change the system because they're still going to sit there and vote with how they feel. So if we can give them some data and information on how to feel, I think that can help. It won't make the problem go away, and it is a lot of work, but I think it is work from the individual and from their chair and from their senior colleagues. Now we're going to have discussion and so on, so I just throw some things out there. Last summer I was asked to be a provocateur, which I'm very proud of, because I haven't done anything provocative since May of 1983, when we made up a punk rock band, and anyway, that's another story. And we treated like it was real, which is unethical, so I'll just put that out there, and now you know. I had to go through training on how to be provocative too, and they said, just say stuff to get people talking. It doesn't even have to be true. And I said, but it's about ethics. Still. So these are all true. It's data science, it's not data alchemy. So we've talked about seeing inside the black box. It is not like we've massaged some messy data and the angels sing and truth is revealed. We're learning something and being able to replicate it and do it in a scientific way. It is science. We're trying to get to the truth through careful steps and documentation. I would like to shift the question from, do we know the answer to that motivating question, or do we know more than we did before? So, and if I go around again, can I do it the same way? Would I learn the same thing? Would I learn a little what I need to know. Humility in science has been mentioned a couple times, and I think it's really important. We are promoted by being very proud of what we do, but I think good analyses may contain technological marvels, but great analyses are going to contain humility. And now, epidemiology, we're generally good at this. We have the sort of angsty, this could be biased, it could be this, it could be that. But most branches of statistics don't, or science don't embrace that quite as well as I think we've been trained to do. So we do want to say, I've learned this, this is how I got it, here's what I don't know, and here's what's next. False positives are just going to happen. I'm tired of reading them as if it's a problem with the algorithm to correct. And anyone who took an intro probability class in public health had this problem. We have a test with 99% sensitivity and this specificity. Should we give it to everybody? When I took this in 1980X, just putting in it was HIV test. Should we test everyone in the United States with an HIV test, which is really good? And then we talked about screening. So should we do TSA tests for men who are 40? Should we do mammograms for women who are 40 and put the letter down? So what happens if the prevalence starts going down, the most of the positives you get are going to be are false positives. That's just what happens when you roll it out. So you need to be selective on where the test goes. So you can find a needle in a haystack if you control the size of the haystack. I think we forget that this is kind of baked into rolling it out. Theranos, the bad blood story. We got a drop of your blood and we tested it for everything. All of them have good sensitivity and specificity, but almost everything you get back, even if it worked. So that's another story. But if it worked, it'd still have a challenge in interpreting it. And then this issue came up earlier. Is anything de-identified? Speaking of mythology. I work in geographic information systems. The New York Times has had a wonderful series of articles about location data, and if it goes from my house to my work every day, that's my path. If I stop at my, you know, an AA meeting, or I stop at, you learn a lot about, and it may be just a couple people you find out, but it's certainly not de-identified. So saying we're stripping the names, I think, gives us a false sense of security, and a lot of data scientists are very anxious to link data together, and maybe not maliciously, but they're like, oh, I can figure that out. It's just, it's what we do. We see that as the question, and we go around the cycle. So I'll stop there.
Okay, great. Lots to chew on there. I wanted to start with, Jeff, you mentioned that you felt public health was uniquely positioned or in a better position, you know, than other sciences to address some of these issues in data science. Why so, and can you tell us, you know, pick any specific examples to tell us why you think, you know, perhaps public health experts are either more attuned or more able to address some of these challenges.
So I'll be hard pressed to come up with a specific example off the top of my head, but I do think that some of the things that we have talked about up till now, the sort of built-in reliance on things like IRB approval and obtaining informed consent, give public health practitioners, both faculty members and then sort of translated down to students, a little bit more respect for that part of the process. And I think when folks in public health spend time thinking about data, I think based on the data that we interact with, very often we spend a lot of time asking, where did these data come from? Who was represented in that sample? Can I learn about the population that I care about from the sample that I have? And sort of thinking about what data you get on that side. And then sort of on the other side asking, what is the thing that I want to learn about? And has that been accurately measured? Is the data that I have in front of me valid for caring about the thing that I want to measure? And so I think that sort of is baked into public health practice through a combination of biostatistics and epidemiology and other training. And I think that really matters, sort of the conceptual framework that people in public health have for where data comes from and what questions you might be able to answer. I think that there is at least some amount of self-selection, that people who go into public health generally go into public health because we want to make some positive change in the world, right? We're here in a school of public health because what we care about is improving the health of populations. And there are people in other disciplines where that is true, that you go into something else because, you know, you have a sort of moral guidance that's something that you want to do. But I think the concentration in public health just tends to be much higher. So I don't have any like specific examples off the top of my head, but I just sort of think the general ambiance gives public health practitioners at least a leg up in thinking about the ethical implications of data science.
Yeah, Francesca.
Yeah, just a quick comment, couldn't agree more. I think another way to synthesize is that in the same way
a physician training is based on the principle of do no harm the patient. I think in public health training, even if it's not explicitly, we do, and we practice every day, and we are trained with the principle do no harm population, whatever population we are talking. So I think it's a kind of an intrinsic principle that we train and practice.
And I'll add, Jeff made the point about biostatistical and epidemiologic training. Public health is often, the way we were taught to interact with data is an observational setting. That's not the case in a lot of sciences that are more experimental. In experimental science, you feel like if you can control things, then you should control them and get a good view. But in the observational setting, we do have concerns that maybe it came up for another reason. And so we bake in a little bit of that humility, if, you know, maybe that's a bold statement, but we do try to have students question what they're seeing and if it may be due to how they saw it rather than what they measured.
Hmm. With respect to this, the vortex that you mentioned, you know, and the ability that perhaps we're too focused on having a question and trying to find the answer to that question, let's talk a little bit about then the, you know, you talked about in epidemiology and public health, it's primarily observational data, the kinds of data that we have, how we collect data, because that seems to be the start, right? It's not objective necessarily, and what you get out of it depends on what you put into it, and it really starts with the collection of the data, how you collect it, how the data boxes are defined, you know, how you define race, how you define X, Y, Z, all of that influences what comes out. How do you see, you know, when you look at that vortex, how do you see, you know, going around in that circle and understanding, you know, the different ways that the collection of the data can affect that? How do you see that working out? And do you see more of that happening today? Are you more optimistic in seeing, like, we're more aware of it today than assuming, you know, for example, that, like, oh, we've got this data set, it was collected, let's put it through the algorithm and see what comes
out. I think there's always been, in a lot of data science has been excitement about how to do things. And so building an intuition of how things work is important, but also building an intuition on where did these data possibly come from? What are some of the stories that could go into getting there in front of me? A lot of epidemiology, I'd argue too, is also measuring the unmeasurable. We talk about measuring disease and measuring exposure as sort of our simplest thing, but how do you measure exposure? I mean, Gary talks about the exposome. I can't measure everything I was ever exposed to my whole life. But I still think that's a good goal. That's an aspirational goal to understand where have I been? What has my general experience been? What kind of city was I in? What kind of path, what way do I get to work? Understanding those things, knowing, you know, just trying to learn more than you could start with. Last week I was at a workshop on the epidemiology of love and compassion. And everyone in the room felt like they were the only person that ever worked on this because their colleagues gave them a hard time. I mean, honestly, we're easier to work on bad outcomes than good outcomes. And one of the questions was, well, how do you even measure it? We said, well, how do you measure stress? How do you measure income? How do you, you know, is SES really a thing that we measure? We take a lot of proxies for it. Mm-hmm. What's your neighborhood feel? So I do think in public health, if we can train them to think about the data's telling you something about it, but it you might be able to get a little bit closer. Then it stops the tendency to go linearly and end and think that answers the whole question. So again, we're sort of cycling around something that we're trying to get a better handle on than before.
Jeff?
I was going to interject. So I think lots of data science entities get data that is in fact observational. I just worry that they don't recognize it as such, right? Like Facebook has observational data. It's not like they have a random sample of everyone in the world. They got people who signed up for Facebook, and same with Fitbit and same with Apple Watch. And what I worry about is Facebook or Fitbit or Apple Watch or somebody using those data to make sweeping claims about the population when really they're just focused on this narrow self-selected group of people. And so I think the point that I'd like to make is that at least in public health, if we had access to those data, we would ask at the outset, who do I think is represented here? And in what ways do I have a sample that's representative of people that I care about?
I wanted to actually, that's perfect, because this is the perfect segue I wanted to say. I think that in this new era of data science within the field of observational study, there's been a really paradigm shift, because in the general area of public health and epidemiology before the data science revolution, even when we talk about observational data, it was about designing a study. You design a study, you decide who to measure, you wait 10 years, and you collect the data. And that's still true, and this is so fantastic. But I think what has been happening in the last few years, because we can measure everything, even in the area of observational data within data science, is shift. It's about, it's much more about grabbing data from different sources. So they are cheaper, they're faster, and it's about combining this data and harmonizing the data. And that's where I think is still, you know, so in one hand, it's, which is basically what has been my research. So in one hand, it's great because it's faster, it's cheaper, you have larger database. But on the other hand, again, has not been designed, has not been checked, has not been evaluated. And so a lot of the conclusion and a lot of the problem, including the ethical problem, you know, tends to be bigger. So even within the observational study, I think that there is a movement. And finally, the other thing I want to say is that there is a really great value of combining the old type observational data, the one that's been designed, with the new type. So one example, the CDC used to use the CDC data to predict flu trends, and that they are always not enough up to date, and the CDC data is better in quality, but are not readily available. If you combine CDC influenza data with Google searches, mm-hmm. you get much better prediction. But if you will use each of these data sources independently, that, you know, the results will be terrible.
I'm glad you brought that up, because that was one example that I was going to bring up and get your perspectives on, as far as, you know, really the two different ways we can collect data, right? And the kind of quote-unquote modern way of doing it, which is, as Jeff, you said, the sort of kind of mass, just, you know, throw the net out there and see what you get, which would be the Google search. You know, I mean, that could tell you everything from mm-hmm. someone who actually has the flu, is concerned they have it, to someone who's just like, okay, it's winter and it's probably flu season, so, you know, I need to learn a little bit more about it. How do you see, I mean, you just talked about the value of combining them and how more predictive and accurate that can be. How, knowing that we've got sort of these two kind of pots of data and the way that they're collected, how do you see being able to combine them in a very useful and fruitful way for, you know, purposes of being able to help people and promote public health and actually do something to say, you know, here's somewhere where we might send more flu shots because we're seeing, you know, a spike in cases here, or here's where we might send, you know, more public health persons to, you know, educate people about symptoms and make sure that they get their flu shot. How can we combine those two in a way that's responsible and ethical and accurate and useful and statistically significant? That'll give us some good, solid data.
Yeah. You want to start? I can. Okay. It's a hard question. Talking about humility, I'm not sure I have the answer.
But, and one that, though, one, probably, right, but, that we should be addressing, because it's the kind of data we'll probably be getting more and more of.
I think that, you know, the nice, I mean, in a positive perspective, is that I think that one really wonderful aspect of the training that, you know, especially actually in epidemiology and biostatistics, some in statistics too, is really these principle of biases, like selectional bias, confounding bias, publication bias. So we have a very good understanding and principle of how to make sure, and actually Lance mentioned about that, that even from the traditional observational data, we kind of know how to avoid the trap of, you know, different types of biases. So when new data comes in, I think that, again, with the guiding principle, is actually an opportunity, because I think we do have already the tool in place, in addition, of course, of new methodological development, that can quickly allow us to assess whether or not this new source of data, the Google data, is measuring a representative population, the same population of the traditional, is measuring variables that we don't know anything about, that do we have it more accurate? So I think there are a lot of things that we can, you know, that we can do to make sure that when we combine the data is done in a proper value, including, it goes back to the humility, recognize that sometimes these additional sources of data are not useful. And that's something also that we need to recognize. The other point that is really important to, I think, to make, and there is a paper that my colleague Zhao Li Meng wrote about this, and it's called the big data paradox. I think also we need to recognize that big data doesn't mean more information. And so there is now, there's been a statistical literature for a long time, but it's also important that it's not always that getting more data, you are in a better position. Because if you're getting more data and the data is imprecise and is affected by all sorts of biases, it's actually worse because you're gonna be more sure about something that is wrong.
So I guess the question really is then, how do you know if you can rely on that data? You know, if we're increasingly going to be seeing it coming from the Googles, the Apples, the validation. Facebooks of the world.
Yeah.
Some of what we need to do is kind of calibrate our expectations too, I think.
Right.
It looks fancy because it's a computer.
Right. Sounds great.
And the number has 18 decimal points after
right.
it. So it looks really accurate.
It's 50 million people.
Yeah. But we
they can't
to,
be wrong.
I think some points that came up earlier, Donna raised these about there. Sometimes it's not science we need to know. We just need more information to do good policy and implementation. The implementation, if we hold everything up to a causation science type investigation, it's kind of the fallacy of the transparency thing a bit too. It's saying, well, if I don't know every data about everybody else, so how do you know it's going to work for this? Well, prediction has an important role here, even if causation's not right. That can be taken too far, like everything we're saying. But I do think, like in epidemiology training, the causal inference stuff is really, really interesting. It's complicated and it's hard, but that's a particular subset of what we do. And we have some good methods for doing some good things. The method might not be new, but it's still a very valuable one. So that's why I think that last step in the cycle is important, evaluating what question did you really answer, at what level, and how would it be useful? So it gets to Stephanie's storytelling too. I understood this. It's not claiming I found the cause for this. In some cases, you might say I know more about the cause of it. The other one might say, if we look at Google searches on high school basketball scores, it's a good predictor of flu because they both go up in the fall. Mm-hmm. And that might be a good enough to say, oh, they're trending up. And I know it's not causal on a public health causation sort of thing,
right.
But it may be a signal that's cheap and easy to measure that gives me good information for starting my flu vaccination communication campaign.
Right.
So I don't want to hold everything to science with a capital S level as much as I like the idea of finding truth, but I do want to, evaluating utility and putting these things in perspective and knowing if it came from this kind of data, I want to kind of calibrate my expectations this way and that one, rather than saying this is right or this is wrong. I thought Rob had this statement about we need machine learning that says I don't know. So there's an ethics of that's being the right answer.
Yeah.
That I don't have information for it, or I can't say anything about causation, but I can say the predictions tell me that I should be following up, and it's not a big investment to put the turn the advertisements on.
Yeah.
So that's I think that calibration of expectations, and not if we may be concerned it's not causation, but that doesn't mean it has zero value.
So one of the points that came up earlier is that CVS probably knows an awful lot more about how healthy somebody is than their physician might. And I think that's generally true. And I think one of the things that we have to recognize is that there are data repositories that are out there that are valuable that we probably should be finding a way to use. That's if there is a way to partner in a way that is sort of mutually beneficial and ensures good health and everything that you would want with CVS, then maybe that's something that we ought to be looking into. One of the things that I worry about is, I said sort of in my slides that Google is a company and as a result is going to make business decisions rather than things that advance science or advance health. So Google Flu seems like it works really well as a way to augment data that comes from the CDC. But then in 1 year they said, we really are going to start doing auto completion for Google searches. And that wrecked everything. Google Flu was now no longer a viable avenue for keeping that in mind. I do a lot of work with wearable devices, so things like a Fitbit that would give you some idea about how much physical activity a person is getting. And Fitbit manufactures a lot of devices. They have really nice user interfaces. As far as I can tell, if they had a choice between a device that was going to be more profitable and one that gave better measurements, they would probably choose the device that's more profitable. And that's not something that I would have any control over, and that often would be sort of, not transparent to me. And so the things that I worry about when it comes to I guess, like, I do agree that all of those data sources are really valuable and things that we should be using, but we have to maintain some sort of air of healthy skepticism about it.
Or have some kind of framework for evaluating it, right?
Yeah. Right.
And where it's coming from. I mean, would that boil down to, you know, being more stringent about definitions, you know? Again, the collection of the data, because the benefit of those companies is their access, right, to the information and the sheer numbers, which, you know, as we all know, with any kind of study or trial is always the first hurdle is the participants, is the N. So how do we sort of turn that to an advantage then? Is it a matter of saying we need to be more stringent about definitions, and is that something that's feasible in your minds?
So, I mean, I think we need to be more stringent about evaluating the validity of these alternative measurements with the traditional way of measuring health. You know, depends on, right, on the situation. And I think what really means is, right now, even though we all acknowledge the enormous potential of new technologies to measure everything, I think that the traditional, especially in the health field, the traditional way of measuring blood pressure or having a doctor performing an examination, it will still need to be necessary for a long time, because even if you have a faster and alternative way of measuring our health to make conclusions that are so important, you still will need to validate them with respect to, you know, traditional.
Right.
So I think validation of measurements, I think it's really important in the health space. And clearly, I think when we harness data from the social media or from whatever other sources, again, all of the sources of biases. I mean, for example, if you use any app, they ask you, have you enjoyed the app, right? And you say yes, and then if you say yes, they say, would you mind taking this survey? Right? So the survey will be about a highly selected samples, right?
Right.
So, to me, validation is going to be really important for a very long time.
Okay. And then on another issue, which one of the audience members is raising, with growing numbers of partnerships between tech companies and researchers around big health, you know, that we're seeing, how can we ensure maintaining ethical principles, including things like transparency and research? You know, this is another side of the coin to the validation.
Yeah. So I don't think there are any easy answers to that. And I think, you know, partnerships with some organizations are going to be, like, pretty clear, pretty straightforward. This is something they have access, they have a data resource, an insurance company maybe. They have gathered data on a huge number of people, and we can use that in a way to understand what the risk factors are and hopefully target interventions, right? And I think that's, you know, even something like that would give a way for sort of thinking about what precision public health is, like the right intervention for the right population. I think those kinds of partnerships make an awful lot of sense. But I think there are going to be some partnerships where it's unclear why that group wants to get involved with folks in public health. What are they hoping to get out of this arrangement? Is it something that is really in the interest of the people that they have information on, or is it something more like reputational whitewashing? And I think that's the kind of thing that we would have to keep an eye on. I know that there are groups, certainly here at the School of Public Health, that sort of evaluate on a rolling basis whether or not some partnership seems like it meets the ethical standards that we have, that we would want for people who are faculty members here to engage with one of those groups. And I don't think there's some, like, standard easy answer. And there's often, you know, real debate about recognizing that, yeah, this seems like we could be able to do good in this way, but is that offset by the harm that might be done sort of inadvertently?
I don't know if any of you are familiar in particular with the Stanford Heart Study, which was Apple and Stanford and the collaboration there, which seemed like something potentially groundbreaking and forward thinking if we're trying to say, okay, how do we make something like this work? I don't know if any of you are familiar enough to comment on whether you had any issues with it or could see any red flags, but it seemed like something that went through the university IRB, and as you were saying, you know, I'm assuming that the ethical principles of the researchers and the faculty were maintained as far as, like, being able to see the algorithm, understand it, contribute to it, and all of that. But those are the sort of issues that we would need to be aware of if we were to try to take advantage of data sets like that.
Some of the scale at which these things happen, yeah. It may be that the primary motivation for it is a really good thing and mm-hmm. it's mutually beneficial, but there may be, you know, if you're getting all the data, and this is the one good example of it, but we also want to be targeting things. So I think, you know, I think university and company legal teams are trying to work out what do these agreements look like, how prescriptive are they, and it's a challenge because it's all new and unknown.
Right.
But like the example about if you're managing the wearable device data and for a health insurance company, it allows them to provide a more economical, you know, that it's good, their motivation on the money side also lines up with the health side. So there's some things that can line up really well, but there's also a lot of interconnectedness to this that I think is new and maybe underappreciated.
So maybe, you know, this is probably a very bold statement, but to me, whether or not data science as a field will succeed in making a world a better place will rely in part of an ability to work in an ethical fashion hand in hand with the industry. Mm-hmm. I think it's not, you know, I feel strongly that this is something that's challenging to figure it out, but we have to figure it out because that's the, you know, that's where the industry is. So I think on one hand, I feel that also with the decrease in funding from the NIH, there have been more opportunity and more interest. And so at the same time with the explosion of data science in the industry, I think all of the different school of public health, but also now the school of public health, have more opportunity to have engagement with industry. I mean, I want to mention that many faculty now, it's very common in faculty in computer science department to have appointments on Amazon or on Google. Mm-hmm. So I think that the opportunities there, the potential is enormous, but the red flag are also many, and the financial interest and conflict of interest are also many. Mm-hmm. So I think in my role as one of the two directors of the Harvard Data Science Initiative, we have been really working hand in hand with the provost's office to really understand when we are partnering, whether data science initiative, institute, department partner with an industry in data science, where they're giving us data, what a template master research agreement will look like mm-hmm. that will be, you know, going back to the, this is something developed, so then we will make sure that the research is as objective as possible and then meets all of the ethical requirements. And how we use this partnership as a case study to teach our students from day zero, because I also do think that understanding the ethical issues and understanding the complexity, it really only happen when if you are really getting your hand dirty into the issues, because at the higher level, all sounds great, but then it's really the double into the detail, and when you're getting into the financial and into the different bottom line of what the academics want to do with the industry. But to me, you know, above and beyond what we teach the student for the university, understand what is an ethical and mutually beneficial agreement with industry to do data science for good. It's something we haven't figured out, and I think really important to figure out.
So one thing that I'd interject there is I don't know that we can sort of think about like, well, how is academia going to partner with like tech and think that we're sort of where data science is. I think the whole lot, maybe the majority of data science is outside of academia. And I don't remember the exact numbers from Stephanie's slides, but she had remember if it was like hundreds of thousands or millions of job postings per year. Like this is how many people are getting jobs in data science. So much of what's going on in data science is going to be happening outside of academia. And I don't think that means that we can't shape what happens there. I think we can and should engage with that larger data science community to try to set what an ethical framework is and should be. And we're going to be responsible for training a lot of the people who go into those jobs. So recognizing that we're sort of filling that pipeline, and then also knowing that there is some interface that's going to have to happen if we want to sort of continue being part of the data science community. I think we got to do that too.
Right, I mean, that's addressing sort of the next level beyond the collection data. The next is interpreting it, right? Yes. And so that's where, you know, I think academia and the researchers and the trained data scientists can look at, you know, the algorithms and make sure that they are treating the data in the correct way. So sort of in part and parcel to your comment, Francesca, there's a question from the audience on, can the panelists suggest a framework or model for tracking data science ethics? I guess they're asking about markers or milestones for ensuring that, you know, the principles that Jeff and Lance and Francesca you're talking about are adhered to. Hmm. I mean, are there lessons from other industries, frameworks that
so for tracking, say it again?
Data science ethics.
Ethics.
I guess the principles that, you know, you've all referred to in this discussion
to
ensure that they're being followed.
I don't know that this actually would work. But one of the things that I sort of like as a marker is the frequency with which there are really unintended negative consequences as a result of doing data science. And I don't know that that's like a really easy thing to keep track of, at least like, are we becoming more ethical as a field over time? But I think when you sort of look at recent history of like, there are a lot of high profile ethical lapses. There are things that deal with, whether or not Facebook is ethical when they are doing A/B testing to manipulate users' emotions, right? Whether or not it's okay for some company to determine something about recidivism rates and have that actually impact who gets bail and who doesn't, and to see racial biases creep into these things. I think when you start seeing big ethical lapses like that, then you know at least we're not on the right track. And what I would hope is that there are fewer of those things over time, but I don't know that that's like a great way of keeping track of what progress looks like.
I think we're used to these human subjects and animal, you know, IACUC and HIPAA compliant training for working with sort of standard data. And this isn't so much tracking as training. You can do training in responsible and conduct of research without really caring about it. I mean, I'm not suggesting that's the way to do it, but they go, oh, we'll check the box, you'll all come in, and we'll show you some bad examples. You've all been to a presentation that's less than inspiring along those lines. So getting people who are informed and care about this and knowledgeable about it, and, you know, the people who write the philosophy paper and so on, and having them be able to tell the story, or have someone who works in this and tell it, you know, having students or postdocs or trainees or junior faculty see a senior faculty member who doesn't say, oh, geez, I have to get recertified. And they say, you know what's interesting about that? This time around when I read the Belmont report, I noticed that this piece. I do a presentation on data ethics to our biostatistics students, and I take them into one of the stairwells in our building, if everybody's able to do that, because we have some public health artwork that's in the lobby, and then afterwards it goes into the stairwells, and we, you know, there's no happy stories in public health. Also, we have the substance abuse stairwell, and we have the mental health stairwell. And there's one that says, I'm always worried, and every time I go by it, I go, hey, I'm always worried. But there's one that I think is the most single powerful piece of art in our two buildings, our interconnected buildings, and it's in a stairwell, and I walk by it, and I walked by it for a date. It had two pictures. Sort of 1950s era African-American woman, African-American man kind of cut up like paper dolls. So they're wearing sort of the, you know, fancy jazz clothes, but the faces are not there. And they're in position over a manuscript of a paper. It's typewritten with letters, you know, comments written in the corner. And, you know, I've written on papers a million times. So one day I stopped and I thought, I wonder what the paper in the background is. And it was a first draft Tuskegee paper. And, you know, I stand there looking at that going, oh my gosh. You know, I thought it was sort of an interesting picture before. So I take, you know, 20 students at a time into the stairwell and I say, look at this. This is a study where the scientist was making grammatical corrections but completely blind to the bigger picture. Because in the name of doing good science, they were zoomed in on the final question and missing some of this. And, you know, to me, I think that should be in our lobby just because I think it's the best piece of art we have in the most powerful message. So there's a lot of ways to convey this that get out of checking a box of what's the right multiple choice answer, but we tend to reduce it to that because it's expedient and it's time and we can check the box. And so finding, you know, the faculty members in your organization who find this interesting and can convey it with some enthusiasm, I think can make a big difference in how long it sticks. You can meet your requirement, but I think this goes above and beyond. So that's a personal opinion, but these are just things that once I started looking at it, I got more and more interested in it.
Well, I wonder too whether your model of the vortex is also helpful here, where if we can think, and instead of, you know, thinking linearly, think that, you know, we're going to be coming back around and giving it another litmus test, you know, like road testing it again and road test it again and make sure each time
right.
we cycle
around. And acknowledging around. You've made a compromise yeah. at some point and you yeah. just are going to make compromises, but what is the impact of that compromise?
Right.
How can I do better next time?
Right. Another question from the audience here is, again, this is relating to ethics, is does the compulsion to publish, again, an issue obviously with data scientists, compromise ethics, and how can the field guard against that? You know,
oh, we have I mean, there's examples of, you know, yeah. doctored images and everything yeah. just to get on the cover of the journal.
Right.
So I think the, so I don't know if it's the, it's not the internal, there's certainly pressure to publish. And there are people who feel that by cutting some corners they can do better. And there are people who have succeeded that way. So I do think, I don't think that's the majority of us, but, and I think there's also a publishing culture. I'm getting a little disillusioned by receiving a paper to referee, you know, feeling bad for rejecting it, and then it comes back as it was for the next journal over. So people are just, you know, there's so many journals out there, just keep sending it until it sticks. I don't think spaghetti publications may be the best way to go.
So one of the things that came up earlier was whether or not there are folks who are interested in staying in academia, but find sort of the requirements of academia to not be something that they want to do. That, you know, you do have to publish, and not just like publish frequently, but you have to like publish papers. You can't sort of do good analyses that are reproducible, that make some useful contribution. You can't check whether or not something else was a valid publication the first time around. And you start seeing, we sort of talked about it in the context of whether or not there is a brain drain from academia, people leaving academia to go into tech. And is that solely attributable to higher salaries in tech, or is it something that's going on? I think, like, I agree, it's something that's going on in academia. And I think one of the things that we probably ought to do is think about what are the things that those people who would be good in academia but are choosing to leave, what are the things that they value that we don't seem to be valuing, and what are the ways that we want to keep those people here? Because I think a lot of the people who have become influential in the data science community are sort of vaguely disillusioned applied statisticians and data scientists who have gone out into the world to do really, really good things, but didn't want to do those really good things in the context of academia because of a pressure to publish, because the things that they wanted to do weren't going to be explicitly valued. So I agree.
Yeah. So I have so much very strong opinion about this. So yes, absolutely. I think the pressure to publish compromise ethics, but most importantly, when together compromise the science. And you know, even though I'm myself probably one of the guiltiest persons, on this, but I, you know, and it's very hard. That's what I repeat myself every day, and I don't do it. I do believe that we need to change the system to actually slow down and do less and better, because I actually do think that data science technology, new data, bigger computer are, you know, without the rigor and the values and the humility, it's actually becoming, you know, not helping anybody, is actually creating confusion and not better science.
So because it's there, we're doing it.
Yes, and I think that we see it how many times, you know, with the dietary recommendation or with all kinds of, you know, all kinds of recommendation, all types of information, we first say one thing and then another things. But also I think in general, we could harm more than doing good. And so it's interesting because when there was a previous question about a framework, so in the context of a specific study and in a specific, you know, try to get the truth, what will be a paradigm and what will be the principle to be as ethical as possible? You know, you will have to think about document data provenance, try to make the data available, try to reproduce the analysis, have the best possible method, validate every single measurement, allow everybody to reproduce your analysis, being absolutely honest and comprehensive about the limitation. Well, that, the reality is, in this climate of competition for getting academics job and funding, people, you can't do that, because if you're gonna do that, you're gonna publish one paper maybe every 2 years. Mm-hmm. So I think that this is really something I feel very strongly about, of how as a community in data science, we value quality instead of quantity, and it's a such hard thing because you have to, you know, thinking about paradigm shifting. But I do think one simple way is now if we are not ready for that, but if we have principle of data ethics, then that's something that should be valued more than scientific output, you know, both for promotion and for grants in general.
Mm-hmm. There's also a tendency in some of the high profile, there's these generations of publication. There's the publishing because you can. You did something bigger than anybody else did. Mm-hmm. And then there's the follow-up stuff that doesn't get as much press of how should you do this? What's a good way? Microarrays are a good example of this. We can measure all these genes at once. And then, well, maybe you should design it a little better. And the design papers have transformed its utility, but they weren't the high-profile publications. Right. I mean, looking back, you can say these are the foundational contributions, but they weren't. That's not how it played out. And David Donahoe gives a great presentation about the drivers of why machine learning moves in the way it does, and the value, it's the competition model for Kaggle and so on. There's no feedback for doing it more efficiently than someone else. And this is, you know, the distributed computing support for this. You'd like someone to use all your servers as much as you can and see what you can do with it. But that if that's the value for winning, and that puts you on top of the pile for promotion and so on, then everyone's going to do that to meet those criteria. So I think we need to take a hard look at some of these criteria of what drives our science, because some of it is what's available to us because we can do it, and we lose the motivation of if the question was really trying to get at a cause of a disease or the effectiveness or the appropriateness of implementation. That if that's the driving question, we should evaluate it on that question, but we often evaluate it on other things because there's so many steps in the process, and I'm guilty of doing this too. If I can get it on a map and see it, I'm like, I won. You know, that's I want to make a better map than somebody else, but it might not be the right map.
Now, Francesca, you started the discussion out with the description of your work and how it's being sort of twisted, and how data, and again, this I think goes to the core of the problem, is how data can really be looked at in so many different ways and interpreted in so many different ways. Lance, you brought up the example of basketball scores and flu rates, you know, and one of my very first social science experiments was our professor was trying to teach us that very lesson and said, you know, go into this social science database, pick two things, see if you can find a correlation. You can find red cars and people have heart attacks, and you could find a correlation, right? But without a hypothesis, you know, it doesn't really mean anything. What do you do when, you know, the data, as you've done, you know, to the best of your ability, as you said, within all the limitations, but following all the rules of data science, and it's presented, and it gets interpreted that way, because this goes beyond the collection of data. Now it's how it's interpreted and how it's applied, right? And it's being applied in a way that you and your team and the researchers never intended. How do you combat that? Is there anything data scientists can do, or is there anything the field can do to address that and to ensure that, you know, the interpretation and the application of the data is going in the right direction?
Yeah, I mean, I think, what I've been trying to do is to pretty much ignore what is said about the other interpretation of my study or what other people saying, and keep producing good science. Because I think that all of us have a very limited amount of time and resources, and so I learned, and by the way, this doesn't apply to me, to me and every other colleagues is doing climate change and air pollution research using data, is that you can use all your time to reply to this letter, to say, no, you're wrong, I'm right, or, you know, to show that they're, you know, and keep going, which you will gonna get into this down spiral loop going anywhere. Or you can leave them alone, let them to say whatever you want, and just keep doing good science and good data, because what I said to everybody is that the political administration, the political thinking comes and goes. Good data, good science stay, you know, in the peer review. Then to be honest with you, I have no idea if it's the most effective way. But I use that, you know, I use the endurance and the resiliency approach than the short term, let's have a fight. But that's what I do. I don't know if it's the most effective.
Okay. And just in closing, I want to pull up a question from the audience too, which is any key suggested readings, books or articles that you would recommend for people? I think that's a good way to close this discussion on yeah.
So I've been, I don't know Naomi Raskas, I never met her, but I've been recommended this book, which is the title is Why Trust Science. So she has a TED Talk. As I said, she does history of science. I've been reading this book, I found it very inspirational because it helps me to understand over many years how would there be the different approaches to gain trust in science, and made me think about what would be the ethical principle with new sources of data, so then we can improve the trust in science instead of being twisted in a different way. So that's just a reading I've been personally reading.
Okay. Enjoying. Why trust in science?
Why trust in science?
Yeah. Yeah. I mentioned that I fell a little bit down a rabbit hole of like philosophical papers on data ethics, and I think actually that was a useful thing to do. It changed what my outlook was, and there's more papers than you might expect from philosophers thinking about data science and data ethics. And so I started with a Google search and I read like four, five, six, seven papers, and I would recommend just doing that because it really was informative and it changed my outlook a little bit.
And on the training side, I really like that paper by Elliot Stokes and Cal that I mentioned, the cross-cultural. It's sort of eye-opening. It may not tell you exactly how to do everything, but it gets you thinking about it. A second book, I have two other books to recommend, or that wasn't a book, but I'm reading a book by Paul Woodruff called Reverence, Renewing a Lost Virtue. It sounds like it would be an inspirational religious book. And he's talking about the concept of reverence and the altar, not from a religious setting. He's a classics professor looking at ancient Greece and ancient China for mechanisms, the idea that the opposite of reverence is hubris, that you know everything and you're totally in charge. I think that's an aspect that it's a lovely little book, and I loaned it to someone who lost it, so I got another copy. And then finally, this may sound like an old reference, but I think The Band Played On, looking at how as HIV and the AIDS epidemic came around and the political groups and the scientific groups, we often look too close to right now, and we tend to think, and so some of you in the room are thinking HIV wasn't that far away, which it wasn't, but in looking back on it now, the partial information that's available by the activist groups, the scientists, the government, and all that, I was sort of hoping it was going to be a stinging indictment of certain groups, but everybody got things wrong along the way with an intention of kind of moving. So I think in retrospect, it's a very interesting public health big picture book to look at from this ethical lens of, you know, it's not so much, we don't know almost everything right now. So how can we, you know, how might I be mistaken as a part of the humility of science, I think, and the implementation of the scientific finding. So it may be a little dated, but I would recommend that if it's not directly about this issue, but just put yourself in that context, and it's eye-opening.
And especially when we think about where we are today, right?
Right.
And that,
exactly.
So that's where we began and look
right.
at where we
and
are
so
today.
What, yeah, I think there's a, we can burn it to the ground. So I do think it's important to say truth to power, but you also have to ask, who's saying truth to my power every once in a while, and am I listening to them?
Well, thank you, Francesca, Jeff, Lance, for your perspective and advice on navigating data science in coming years, which, you know, as we all discussed, is going to be really challenging as we see corporate entities like Google and Apple enter this space, as well as you know, the emergence of machine learning and AI approaches, which people will try to fit into to public health. So thank you so much for your lessons and perspective.
Thank you.